who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. 'Cause you laid down your love that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order and makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your love that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love, you are love. On display for all to see, you are light, you are light. When the darkness closes in, you are hope, you are hope. You have covered all my sins. You are peace, you are peace. When my fear is crippling, you are true, you are true. Even in my wandering, you are joy, you are joy. You're the reason that I sing. You are life, you are life. In you death has lost its sting. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough, 'cause nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever. Than my words will ever say. You are Lord, you are Lord. All creation will proclaim. You are here, in your presence I'm made whole. You are God, of all else I'm letting go. I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, I'm running to your. Your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world, forever reign. Forever reign. My heart will sing. No other name. My heart will sing. No other name, Jesus, Jesus.
Well, today, if you haven't figured it out, I'm going to speak a little bit on obedience. And could have picked some people that were very obedient. Names like Daniel, names like Joseph, some other folks in the Bible that were maybe maybe not, definitely not perfect, but maybe better examples than the three fellows that I'm going to be talking about tonight. Jonah, Samson, and Gideon, they all accomplished certain tasks. To varying degrees, they were successful. But I like to focus on obedience. I guess God's been putting it on my heart about obedience. And it goes back to when Saul did the sacrifice, when he was supposed to wait for Samuel to arrive to do the sacrifice. And Samuel's like, God, you know, he prefers, I'm paraphrasing, obedience to sacrifice. And God wants our obedience. And, you know, as people, we're going to fall short. That's not to make excuses, but obedience is something we should strive for. And I guess I've thought a lot about that. Just completed a VBS and have some kids that are wild, including my own. And I know one thing is when they're not obedient, they miss out on a lot. You know, if you're teaching or there's a lesson or a craft, much like in our lives, if we're not obedient to what God wants us to do, our calling in life, our ministries, we can miss out on a lot. And he'll find somebody else to fill in the gaps if we're not taking care of what he wants us to do. And not to add myself to the list, but I know having spent years of not following the Lord and not being obedient to his word, there's a lot of years that are just, they're gone, and I won't get them back. I don't dwell on that too much, but obedience is a subject that it hits home, and we're going to have some fun tonight, a little bit of fun, as we go over these three guys. I will tease them a little bit. It's okay. They're dead. But I believe they're all with the Lord, and they'll get me later. But we're going to have a little fun with them tonight, okay? And prayerfully, we can glean some things from their mistakes and glean some things from their successes. And the Bible, as I tell the youth, the Bible is God's book of, not as an instruction book, not only is it an instruction book, everything points to Jesus. It's filled with people who are imperfect examples for us to follow and give us more and more reasons why we need a Savior, why we need Jesus, okay? So I'm going to say a little prayer, and then we're going to dive in to Jonah, no pun intended. Dear Lord, thank you for this evening. Thank you for my brothers and sisters here as we go through the book of Jonah, Lord, and get to know a little bit more about what happened with him, also with Samson and with Gideon, Lord. We look forward to what you have in store. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. And the old saying, you know, the first shall be last. Well, the last will be first. So chronologically, Jonah happened after Samson and Gideon. So we're going in reverse order, just for you Bible scholars out there. So don't throw anyone. One thing, I didn't put the verse on a slide, but I want to say the verse. I'll say it now at the end as well. The verse that was sticking out to me lately was John 14 and verse 15 and then verse 21. I'll read them back to back. Jesus said, "If you love me, keep my commandments. And he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father. And I will love him and manifest myself to him." So obedience equates to love in God's eyes. If we obey him, if we're being obedient to him, we're showing him love. And that obedience is a very powerful thing. It's something that we should strive for. So here we go. Jonah. I am flipping. Where am I? Almost got it. Sorry. Forgive me, I'm going to the table of contents because my brain's not working. It's a small book, it's like 2 pages. Ah, there it is. And I like the picture. I painted that earlier this morning. Not really. But I like it. It was just when he's cast up on the beach. Ah, there we go. Going to be doing a lot of reading through the scriptures today. Just a little background. Jonah is told by the Lord to go to the city of Nineveh. Nineveh was, and he wanted to tell them to repent, or there is going to be a coming judgment. The deal with Nineveh is it was full of Assyrians. And the Assyrian Empire, they were a fun bunch. They had stone carvings on their walls of Jews impaled on spears. That was their artwork. They would often, if they captured you in battle, they would put a hook through your cheek and lead you on a chain. The Assyrians were folks you didn't want to mess with. And the city of Nineveh was their capital city. Rumored was the walls were huge, and the top of the walls were so wide that you could have a chariot race on down the walls of Nineveh. It was a huge city, and the Jews weren't really too fond of the Assyrians, and neither was Jonah, as we'll find out. The current ruins of Nineveh are near the city of Mosul, which is in Iraq, and I've heard a few the Iraqi conflict. There was definitely some battles near Mosul. Okay, Jonah. Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, "Arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and cry against it, for their wickedness has come up before me." But Jonah arose to flee to Tarshish, from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish, so he paid the fare, and he went down into it to go with them to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Okay, so mistake number one. God tells you to do something, Jonah. He says, nope, I'm going the exact opposite way. And it's not clear where Tarshish is, but more or less it's believed that it could be somewhere near Spain. So it was an exact opposite way of Nineveh. And so he gets in a boat thinking he can run from God. And if any of you have ever ran from God or tried to run from God, you know that you can only run as far as you can until you decide to give in and say, okay, Lord, I'm sorry, I'm back. So he was running the opposite way. But the Lord had a plan. He sent out a great wind on the sea, and there was a mighty tempest on the sea, so that the ship was about to be broken up. And then verse 5, the mariners were afraid, not the baseball team, these were the sailors. And every man cried out to his God and threw the cargo that was in the ship into the sea to lighten the load. But Jonah had gone down to the lowest parts of the ship, had laid down, and was fast asleep. One of the few things Jonah has in common with our Lord and Savior Jesus, he could sleep during a storm. My brother-in-law can do that as well, I'd imagine. So the captain came to him and said to him, "What do you mean, sleeper? Arise, call on your God. Perhaps your God will consider us so that we may not perish." And they said to one another, "Come, let us cast lots," or cast dice, something similar to dice, "that we may know for whose cause this trouble has come upon us." So they cast lots, and the lot fell on Jonah. Then they said to him, "Please tell us, for whose cause is this trouble come upon us? What's your occupation, and where do you come from? What's your country, and what people are you?" So they woke him up, they gave him the third degree, because they cast lots, and it determined that it was due to Jonah. So he said to them, in verse 9, "I'm a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord, the God of heaven, who made the sea and the dry land." Then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, "Why have you done this?" For the men knew that he fled from the presence of the Lord because he told them. So he's not shy to let strangers know that he's fleeing from the presence of the Lord. And then they said to him, "What shall we do to you that the sea may be calm for us?" For the sea was growing more and more tempestuous. It's a tough one. And he said to them, pick me up and throw me into the sea. Okay? Now, right then and there, I'm thinking, okay, man, you're running from the Lord. Sailors are asking you, what'd you do? How do we stop it? And he decides to say, pick me up and throw me into the sea. He could have said, you know what? It's the Lord. It's because of me. You know what? Turn this boat around. Take me back to Joppa. Actually, drop me off at Nineveh. He had that chance. But he just said, yeah, pick me up and throw me into the sea. And the sea, and then the sea will become calm for you. For I know that this great tempest is because of me. Nevertheless, the men rowed hard to return to land, but they could not, for the sea continued to grow more tempestuous against them. So they tried to help him out. They weren't giving up. They weren't going to throw him in the water. They were rowing towards land as hard as they could. And therefore, they cried out to the Lord and said, we pray, O Lord, please don't let us perish for this man's life, and do not charge us with innocent blood. For you, O Lord, have done as it pleased you. So they picked up Jonah and threw him into the sea, and the sea ceased from raging. They didn't want to. They were fearful of God. Even though they didn't worship him, they worshiped their own gods, they still were fearful of God because they believed that he had brought the tempest upon them. And then, after they dropped him into the sea, and the sea stopped raging, then it says in verse 16, the men feared the Lord exceedingly and offered sacrifices to the Lord and took vows. That's newfound faith right there. So they knew at least the God of Jonah is the one true God. And now the Lord had prepared a great fish to swallow Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. And right then and there, a lot of people who are critical of the Bible will say, 3 days and three nights in the belly of a fish? That's not possible. No, that can't happen. You'd die. The stomach acids, everything would kill you. How could he do that? Well, I like in Matthew verse 12, 38 to 41, it's Jesus talking, and he's approached by some of the scribes. It says, some of the scribes and Pharisees said to him, teacher, we want to see a sign from you. But Jesus answered and said to them, an evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up in the judgment with this generation and condemn it, because they repented at the preaching of Jonah. Okay, well, I let it out of the bag. They repent. And indeed, a greater than Jonah is here. So my rule of thumb is if Jesus says it and it's true, then it's true. So that's what I'll pull folks to. Having certain debates with folks doesn't always... You don't necessarily need to debate Scripture, because it takes faith. It takes to have a relationship with the Lord to fully get the Bible, fully understand the Bible, fully understand how God loves you, how he died for us. But if Jesus said it, I believe it. I don't need that. I don't need him to say it, but it's extra reinforcement that he did spend 3 days and three nights. Chapter 2. Then Jonah prayed to the Lord his God from the fish's belly. So here he is, stubborn old Jonah, inside a fish's belly. It says, I cried out to the Lord because of my affliction, and he answered me. Out of the belly of Sheol I cried, and you heard my voice. For you cast me into the deep, into the heart of the seas, and the flood surrounded me. All your billows and your waves passed over me. Then I said, I have been cast out of your sight, yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The waters surrounded me, even to my soul. The deep closed around me. Weeds were wrapped around my head. So he had seaweed wrapped around him. Must have been really messed up there. He said, I went down to the moorings of the mountains. The earth with its bars closed behind me forever. Yet you've brought up my life from the pit, O Lord my God. and my soul fainted within me. I remember the Lord, and my prayer went up to you, into your holy temple. Those who regard worthless idols forsake their own mercy, but I will sacrifice to you with the voice of thanksgiving. I will pay what I have vowed. Salvation is of the Lord. So he has, I guess he's got 3 days of stubbornness and 3 days of disobedience to finally come clean and to acknowledge that the Lord is the Lord. And I can't tease him on that, because a lot of us, and myself included, have spent a lot more than 3 days in rebellion. But inside the belly of the whale, I would hope that, okay, Lord, get me out of here. So he did. He admitted, Lord, I need you. So the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. That's convenient. And it was close to Nineveh, too. Now the word, in chapter 3, the word of the Lord came to Jonah the second time, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and preach to it the message that I will tell you. So Jonah arose, and he went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly great city, a 3-day journey in extent. And Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk. And I heard a teaching once of a possibility that being inside of his belly, and this is, you know, if it's not in the Bible, then it's just like I said, the book of second opinions. But it's possible if he was in the belly of a whale for 3 days, the digestive juices in the whale's stomach could have bleached his skin, discolored him. He was wrinkly. He could have looked very, very like, wow, where have you been? You know, I've been in the belly of a fish. Oh, I believe you. So when he entered the city, people may have taken extra notice of him, not taking anything away from God and God's provision that he was going to send Jonah to preach a message of repentance and that they would respond to it. But on a side note, I always picture him, his skin stained white and all wrinkly. If you ever given a 2-year-old a bath after about 20 minutes, his feet look all pruny. So he must have been pruny and white. Then 40 days, yep. So Jonah began to enter the city on the first day's walk, and he cried out and said, yet 40 days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. So the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest of them to the least. And then verse 6, chapter 3, then word came to the king of Nineveh, and he arose from his throne, and he laid aside his robe, covered himself with sackcloth and satin ashes. And that's how they, culturally, that's how people mourned back then. Just think of putting a potato sack on you, a scratchy potato sack on you, and putting ashes on your head. Very uncomfortable, very itchy. It was a way to show mourning. In verse 7, and he caused it to be proclaimed, and the king did, and published throughout Nineveh by the decree of the king and his nobles, saying, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth and cry mightily to God. Yes, let everyone turn from his evil way and from the violence that is in his hands. Who can tell if God will turn and relent and turn away from his fierce anger so that we may not perish? In verse 10, then God saw their works, that they had turned from their evil ways. And God relented from the disaster that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. So God was merciful. God was very merciful to them. But he did what he said he was going to do, and he used Jonah to do it. And here's the kicker. In chapter 4, but it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he became angry. And he prayed to the Lord and said, oh, Lord, was not this what I said when I was still in my country? Therefore, I fled previously to Tarshish, for I know that you are a gracious and merciful God, slow to anger and abundant in loving kindness, one who relents from doing harm. Amen. Therefore now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? So Jonah went out of the city and sat on the east side of the city, and there he made himself a shelter and sat under it in the shade till he might see what would become of the city. So in a sense, he's upset that God's showing merciful to these people, these Assyrians, these people, like I said, that have artwork of fellow Israelites up on skewers like human shish kebabs, carved in granite and carved in rock inside the temples and the walls inside of Nineveh. Going to Nineveh was also almost like a death wish. A commentator, somebody mentioned it. It was almost like if someone from 1940s, a Jew, was to enter a concentration camp and to tell the Nazis to repent and to let them change their ways. I mean, that's the kind of hatred and the fear that was between these two people. The Assyrians were savage people. The Israelis were not perfect either, but it was almost a death sentence for him to go. But God protected him, and God used him. God used Jonah to help them to repent. And now he's angry. In verse 6 of chapter 4, "And the Lord God prepared a plant and made it come over Jonah, that it might be shade for his head to deliver him from his misery. And Jonah was very grateful for the plant. But as the morning dawned the next day, God prepared a worm, and so it damaged the plant and it withered. And it happened when the sun arose that God prepared a vehement east wind, and the sun beat on Jonah's head, so that he grew faint. Then he wished death for himself and said, 'It is better for me to die than to live.'" You know, he's out there sitting on a hill waiting to see if God is going to change his mind, waiting to see if, hey, you know, they said they repented, but maybe God's going to cast down fire. Maybe something's going to happen. Maybe he will judge the city. And now he's sitting there and he's complaining. He's complaining and saying, "It's better for me to die than to live because the sun's on his head." And God said to Jonah in verse 9, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" And he said, "It is right for me to be angry, even to death." But the Lord said, "You've had pity on the plant for which you've not labored, nor made it grow, which came in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh, that great city, in which are more than 120,000 people who cannot discern their right hand from their left, and much livestock?" Putting things in perspective, Jonah, is he obedient? Under extreme duress, under extreme pressure, from the belly of the well, it's like he was right on enough to do what God asked him begrudgingly, and then he's back to denying God and back to being negative and back to not being obedient, back to being rebellious. In the story of Jonah, he's not very obedient to the Lord in many ways, compared to the sailors who threw him over. They were obedient to him, to Jonah. The waves obeyed the Lord. The fish obeyed the Lord. The people of Nineveh obeyed the Lord's words that were given to them through Jonah. But Jonah himself, stubborn man. It speaks to me just that hard stubbornness. But God used him. God used him. And Jonah's not perfect, obviously, but 120,000 lives were saved. And it's very troubling when we have an example like this, because I can see how hard our hearts can be towards certain people or certain groups, certain biases, certain things that we might be raised with, certain preconceived ideas about some people that, oh no, I don't want to talk to them. I can't stand those people. I don't want that to happen. The fact that he was obedient, but it was just like a partial obedience. And then he was complaining about the good work that God had done. If any of us And yes, I'm picking on Jonah. It's okay. If any of us, God said, hey, go over and talk to that person, the Circle K, I will. Hey, Jesus told me, I felt like the Holy Spirit was moving in me. I'm like, what? But I feel that I need to tell you that God loves you and that everything's going to be okay. And that person goes, whoa. Those words change a person's life. And you end up having a conversation and end up being saved. Well, here's a prophet, a man of God who is used so mightily for 120,000. I mean, you know, I don't know if, not to compare apples to oranges, but how many people have ever been saved in one Billy Graham, one mission, or one radio speech, or one Chuck Smith this, or one any of this, but 120,000 people, okay? That's, I don't know, something to think about when it comes to obedience. God can use even the hardest heart to get his will done. And then we've got Samson, our next man. The thing with Samson, he wasn't really a spiritual leader. He was led by two things, women and revenge. And throughout the story of Samson, we have to understand that where he's at. At this time, it's the tribes of Israel have entered the Promised Land. And the Israelites did not remove all the Canaanites, so they're living amongst these foreign people, the Canaanites, with their culture. And not to use a Star Trek term, but the Israelites are being more assimilated into the Canaanite culture because it's easier to pull someone down than to build someone up. So they're amongst the Philistines, their neighbors, and the Philistines are they're the main antagonist right now with Israel. They've got better weapons. They've got iron, while the Israeli people have bronze weapons. They're stronger. They're in a bigger number. And God's purpose for Samson was that, bear with me, God's purpose for Samson was that he would begin... He would begin the, bear with me. He would begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. So that was his purpose. In Judges, the book of Judges, chapter 13, verse 5, Samson's mother is told, "For behold, you shall conceive a son and bear a son, and no razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines." So that was his job. That was his mission, to begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. I like that picture. It's a little bit bloody and such, but it's the Bible. It's there. And this period of time of the judges, the children of Israel were in a cycle. The people of Israel, they would worship idols. They'd fall away from the Lord. And then God would allow an oppressor. In this case, with Samson, it was the Philistines. The children of Israel would cry out, "Ah, Lord, Lord, ah." Then when God would send, God, Israel would repent and say, God, please help us, help us. And then God would send a hero or a judge to help save them from the situation. And it's a continual cycle in this portion of Israel's history. So with Samson, his mother let him know that he was going to be a Nazarite. A lot of other things, I don't have the full list, but mainly he was not supposed to cut his hair, not supposed to touch dead things, not supposed to drink wine of any kind. There are a few other things that he wasn't supposed to do, but he was set apart. And the deal with him was, like I said, he wasn't a spiritual leader. He was a man of passions, a man of lust. He's like one of those guys that would get in trouble, would probably get you in trouble, like too much testosterone. Whenever I picture Samson, you see the movies, and he's big and he's brash and he's ready to fight, and he's not a he's not what you call a godly man, but God's still going to use him. One day, I'm going to say, start in chapter 14, Samson went down to Timnah, and forgive me, Samson was walking one day, and he comes across a lion, a young lion, and he kills the lion. And he comes back later, and he sees inside the lion's carcass that there is a honeycomb with some bees around it, and he dips his finger in, and he eats it, and it's sweet. And that's important, because in chapter 14 of Judges, Samson says he went down to Timnah and saw a woman in Timnah of the daughter of the Philistines. And he went up and told his father and mother, saying, I've seen a woman in Timnah of the daughter of the Philistines. Now, therefore, go get her for me as a wife. And I can't do like that typical, stereotypical, that accent. Can't you find the good Jewish girl? I mean, the parents say, is there not a woman among the daughters of your people? I mean, I can't blame them. I don't want my daughter or my son, you know, bringing home somebody that doesn't love the Lord. I mean, it's like, oh, you know, my head's going to roll. I'm putting in the work now that I don't have to deal with that. But I can imagine how they felt. Only imagine. And it... They go and they have a party, a wedding party. And Samson, he's kind of a braggart. And there's 30 men there. And he's like, hey, I'm going to pose a riddle to you. And if you can guess this riddle, I'm going to give you 30 outfits, 30 changes of clothing. So each of you 30 guys, I'll buy each of you guys a new outfit at the local American Eagle they had down there. And that's a clothing store. Just kidding. And they said, well, if you can't answer it, then you're going to buy me 30 changes of clothing, 30 outfits. And they said, sure. And he said, out of the eater came something to eat. Out of the strong came something sweet. And for 3 days, it says, chapter 14, verse 15, or verse 14, now for 3 days they could not explain the riddle. And it came to pass that on the seventh day that they said to Samson's wife, soon to be wife, entice your husband, have him explain the riddle to you. If not, we're going to burn your father's house with fire. And his wife was like, okay, I'll tell you. The answer is honey. And then she told them. And so in verse 18, so the men of the city said to him on the seventh day before the sun went down, what is sweeter than honey and what is stronger than a lion? And then Samson said, if you'd not plowed with my heifer, I don't call your wife your heifer, but if you hadn't hassled my wife and got it for my wife, you would have not solved my riddle. And then interestingly, in verse 19, the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him. When the Spirit of the Lord comes upon Samson, look out, because that means he's ready to kill things. And he went out and he went to a nearby town, killed 30 men, took all their clothes and brought them back. And I'm sure they were disgustingly bloody and cut up and messy and gave them to the guys. And after a time, then he went home to mom and dad, sulked for a little bit. And then he went and he brought his wife a young goat, went back to her mom and dad's house to try to work things out. Then he finds out that her dad had given her to the best man. He gets really upset. And so he gets upset and says, in verse 3 of chapter 15, Samson said to them, this time I should be blameless regarding the Philistines if I harm them. And so he took 300 foxes and torches, and he turned the foxes tail to tail, and he put a torch between each of the pair of tails, and he set the foxes out. And they went up and they burned all the shocks of standing grain, and as well as the vineyards and the olive groves. So pretty much burned a lot of fields of the Philistines and their food. And in verse 6, they figure out that, hey, it's Samson. And the reason why they did that was because their father, the father had given his wife to another man, and so they burned her, and they burned his wife, and they burned her father with fire. And I can go on a little bit more about Samson's exploits, but pretty much gets to a point where Samson's, even his own people, are brought to bring him in. And he's like, look, there's 3,000 Israelites coming to get Samson. And he's like, okay, I'll go with you to the Philistines, but just don't kill me yourselves. And they said, no, we're not going to kill you, Samson. They tied him with ropes, they bring him before the Philistines, and then the Spirit of the Lord came upon him, boom, it's action time. And he goes, next thing you know, he's killing Philistines, kills over 1,000 with a donkey's jawbone. And I can't even imagine, even with modern technology, one man being able to kill 1,000 men with even like a good rifle. That would take a lot of effort, especially, but he had the Lord helping him out. So on and on, Samson eventually hooks up with Delilah, and she lulls him into telling the secret of his strength after nagging him for days, and it's his hair. He gives in, and at that point, she cuts his hair while he's sleeping. He wakes up, Samson, the Philistines are upon you. But he's too weak. His eyes are immediately gouged out. He's blinded. He's taken to a temple. He's chained between two pillars. And then he says one of his two prayers, hey, Lord, in verse 16, chapter 30, let me die with the Philistines. And he pushed with all his might, and the temple fell on the Lord's and all the people who were in it. So the dead that he killed at his death were more than he'd killed in his life. His life, he did what he was set out to do, to destroy and to start the destruction of the Philistines. But I'm just thinking, how would Samson would have been different had he lived a different life? Would he have lived longer? Would he have killed more people? Would he have done more good? But God used him. God used him. Was he obedient? He was obedient to his calling. There's not a lot of times where God tells him what to do. He reacts out of vengeance, out of anger, out of frustration. And a lot of it is due to his lusts. That was Samson. And as far as the Philistines, their reign, or I should say the job, wasn't finished until David finished the job later on in life. King David took care of him. As far as Gideon goes, there's a lot to be said about Gideon and his obedience. He's met by an angel, the angel of the Lord, who tells him, hey, mighty man of valor, hello, we need you to help out with the Midianites. And the Midianites were a group of people who would come in during the spring. They would take the grain, they would take the cattle, they would come in and just rob the people of Israel. And it was one of the first cavalries on record. They would come in fast. I guess I learned that the camel can run about 25 miles per hour for up to an hour. That's pretty fast for a camel. And they can do a top speed of 40 miles per hour. So they were a pretty quick force as far as coming in and getting out, doing a lot of damage. But there he is. He's in a hole. He's in a wine press. And pretty much the angel of the Lord's telling him, hey, you need to go and you're going to be called to take care of these Midianites, to get rid of them. And he immediately makes excuses. Well, who am I? I'm from the lowest family, the poorest family in town. Who am I? But God saw Gideon, God saw his heart, And in obeying and convincing Gideon, Gideon asked for a couple of things. He says, "Well, gee, you know, I put a pair of fleece on the ground, and how about it's wet in the morning and the ground is dry?" And that happens. Well, just to make sure, for the next day, how about the fleece is dry and the ground is wet? And so the Lord allows him to have that little bit of testing. And so he says, okay, now Gideon felt he could obey. He was more of a timid at first. And God did a few things to help him out. Gave him some extra confidence before the battle. Gideon called several of the people to come to him. He had about 32,000 men. And then God told him, "Hey, you know, there's still too many." And the Midianites doesn't say exactly, but they were innumerable, so you couldn't count them. So if you've got 32,000 men and you're already outgunned, outmanned, and you know it, and the Lord tells you you've got too many men, I would say, "Really, Lord? Are you sure?" but Gideon obeyed, and he was told to let them know that, hey, if anyone was fearful, to go ahead and to leave. And a great majority of them left. And then the Lord said, "You know what? There's still too many guys here, Gideon." Because, you know, the Lord really, when the Lord works, he wants to show that it's him doing the work, not the people, not us, the vessels, that it's him. And if I could ever get into Gideon's sandals, I'd be very uneasy. But he trusted the Lord. He was obedient. I'd like to think that I would be obedient as well. And then he said, "Hey, take him down by the river, and all the guys that stick their heads in the water and drink from the stream, tell them they can go. And all the men that reach down and bring the water up and lap it up like a dog, they can stay with you." So there's 300 guys. And he sends everybody else home except these 300 guys. It's crazy. The odds. I was reading something, and it says, even though we don't know how many of the Midianites were there, it's estimated that Gideon and his men were outnumbered well over 400-1. Okay? It's just crazy. But he obeyed God. He trusted in the Lord, and he was obedient. And he goes around and he surrounds the camp. He breaks them into three companies of 100 men. They have clay pots with a torch, and they all have a horn in their hand. And Gideon said, "When I start shouting, 'The sword of the Lord and Gideon,' blow your horns and then break your clay pots." So the Midianites are all in a valley. Gideon and his men surround the valley as best they could, 300 guys. The Lord miraculously causes great confusion in the camp of the Midianites, and they end up turning their swords on each other and killing each other and then running. And Gideon ends up chasing them, and his men end up chasing them away. And despite all this timidity, God used Gideon and increased his faith. And you see Gideon, from his obedience, change and have more confidence near the end. And I can't imagine what he went through in his sandal straps, but it's pretty awesome to see the Lord move. And God does that. He doesn't want us to glory in things that he's done. The worst thing you can do is to do something that the Lord has put on your heart to do or has told you to do, and you do it, and then somebody gives you praise for it. "Hey, that was a great job." And for you to take credit for that, you know, especially a miraculous work just as this, whether it's Jonah, 3 days in a fish, preaching the word to repent, and 120,000 people repenting, whether it's Samson, who was just kind of a meathead, but God still used him in his fleshliness. At the end of Samson's life, he did pray to God, and God used him as he said he would. And Gideon, in his timidity, God still used him, and because of his obedience, they were all at different times obedient to the Lord. At different times, their own unique ways. They're very imperfect examples of just like we are, and the Bible's full of imperfect examples. That's why I get a lot of encouragement when I read about these men and read other stories. In Hebrews 12, 1 and 2, it's one of my favorite verses. It says, "Therefore we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." This cloud of witnesses, these men, Samson, Gideon, Jonah, they're a cloud of witnesses. They're men who flesh and blood have gone before us. They're examples. Jesus is the ultimate example, but we have these examples of these imperfect people to give us encouragement, and we can see what their obedience and their disobedience, what their fears, how that all plays into how they live their lives. In Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 5:20, we're called to be ambassadors. Apostle Paul says, speaking to the church in Corinth, he says, "Now then, we are ambassadors for Christ, as though God were pleading through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God." You know, our job nowadays is to be obedient, just as it was in the Bible times for those men and women who lived there. We're called to be ambassadors. We're representing God. We're representing Him. We don't always do that. I put the Calvary Chapel Yuma sticker on my back of my car as kind of a way so I don't get angry when I drive. My kids know. They don't know. I don't say traditional bad words. It's son of a biscuit and other things like that come out of my mouth. But still, they can see my frustration, and it's just as bad as if I was to say one of the more common words. But you know, we are ambassadors. The Bible also mentions in Romans 10:13. It says, "Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You know, if you're here tonight, if you're home listening, and you stumbled across this on the internet, and you go, "Geez, you got something out of it." Well, great. you know, the Lord will use you. The Lord will use you in your imperfections. The Lord will use you to accomplish His will, if you humble yourself, if you obey Him. And to obey Him, you have to be able to hear Him. And to be able to hear Him, you got to be able to know Him. So I just want to close this in prayer and pray for those folks that may be out there listening to this as well. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for my brothers and sisters, God, that we're patient, Lord, and that we're here. And for my brothers and sisters that are maybe online as well. God, you know our hearts, Lord. You know where we have all been obedient and we've been disobedient as well to you, God. And what has happened because of that disobedience, the wasted years. Also through obedience, God, the blessings you've provided to each of us, God. I pray, Father, that we can just know you more, God, be more obedient to you. And I pray for the folks that don't know you out there, Lord. If there is anyone out there, Lord, anywhere, Lord, hearing this, Lord, that doesn't know you, I pray for them right now, Lord, that they'll ask you to be their Lord, Lord, and that they'll follow you, God, and learn to be obedient and understand what obedience to you really means and the benefits of it, God. It's wonderful. It's awesome. There's nothing better, Lord, than being obedient to you, God. We thank you for everything you've done, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's stand together.